Hello everyone, some thought more about the Ottoman expansion in the early 16th century. You know that we have the sort of propedeutic series to the siege of Vienna that allows us to say complement our series about Renaissance warfare with further information and reflecting also some political, religious, cultural aspects of the Ottoman expansion. And through that, essentially the Islamic coming back in the Mediterranean from the late Middle Ages onwards, and especially in the early Renaissance, or in the early modern age, if you prefer. This aspect is fascinating because it allows us to see, I think, the history of the world in more pragmatic, concrete, and sort of accurate ways than the ones that we have somehow fabricated in an anti-traditional way, especially through the concept of the post-Westphalian world and all that sort of line of thought that I honestly never accepted, right? It's not that I don't understand it, or actually am very interested in the consequences of the Treaty of Westphalia, etc. And we will see it hopefully soon at some point. But it's as if there were a sort of self-reference, cultural self-reference. Not indeed, this is the mistake we often commit, right? Criticize Western self-reference as if, you know, there was something outside of the West that we should, you know, take in consideration for. This is a great mistake, right? What cultural self-reference does is, in this case, in our case, mostly not seeing what the West was at the time of, say, whatever, not necessarily the one of the Ottoman invasions, which actually did show some issues that we are still facing today. And so we get to the idea that somehow the last couple of hundred years were some sort of moment of major moral achievement, whereas aside from expansionism, I don't see anything wrong to the slightest with the strongest ruling on the weaker, right? For me, colonialism may be wrong exclusively in the mistake that, you know, brought for it to end, not in the fact that somebody dominated somebody else, which I think it's one of the most obvious achievements, especially in the way that the West was essentially civilizing and radically making to boom the entire rest of the world, because this is essentially what we're still into, right? If other cultures, if other peoples are anywhere by now, the stage in civilizational development they are, they owe it to at least a 50-60% to the West. I mean, this is the macroscopic evidence in their own culture. I mean, they go dressed like Westerners, they do live like Westerners, they want the West, except they hate the West because they're aware of their inferiority and not in complex of their actual inferiority, that I also don't see how it could be really, you know, denied in any way. And that's the actual reason why that's the case. But even worse than that, of course, avoiding to look at what the West was, and so what actually universal tradition was, and also what these cultures were at some point. There were some times in which, say, the West was not as developed, right? If you go as back as the first millennium BC, you can see there that this depends on what you call by West, right? Definitely, if you look at the Achaemenid Empire, you can see a lot of continuity with some ancestral Indo-European connections. You can go as far as saying that the Chinese Empire may have been founded by Indo-Europeans. This is an actual thing, right? Famously enough, in the field of Chinese studies and, say, early history, etc. But this is something we will see at another point. The main problem being, as I was saying, the fact that we have forgotten that the West was exclusively based on the difference of human beings, right? Those who were better than the others had the God-given right to rule over the others, and the entire system of castes, etc., was fundamentally based on the same concept that this diluted over time for reasons that have to do with sort of apathy and tolerance and all these capacities that in some instance, right? If there were, of course, a sound fate and so spiritual value, etc., would even be, say, positive, because they wouldn't hamper our own capacity of actually conquering other peoples and somehow tolerating the fact that they exist, because the only purpose why humanity exists is to conquer the world and divinely transfigure in it, right? To redeem it from its own sins. This was actually a pretty deep and deeply ingrained concept in colonialism as well, that nobody really found anything to object to, and that is being completely removed from our system of education. That is to say, it's not that today you find people that say, oh, okay, you know, the Westerners were bad because they believed in this. Like, it's as if nobody realized that this was the actual value behind it, right? Even if you wanted to say, still at that point, the inferiorly complex would obviously say, well, no, because we were better. Well, yes, and except on the basis of traditional rule, you were under. And so, you know, basically God had forgotten you. And in that sense, forgiven you as well, because, again, somebody was actually working for you in that sense. And yes, again, this is not to say that, you know, things were run well in general, but I'm talking about the conceptual idea of simply conquering other people. There is absolutely nothing wrong in the concept, in my opinion. And the other aspect that I think here is, again, that in the lack of awareness of the social stratification, say the idea that whoever is at the top, or also politically, of course, they all intertwine, also militarily, from individuals, groups, peoples, cultures, countries, whatever, right? This is where the thing gets down to. Those who were under were feeling ashamed enough to be under to try to improve themselves. Right, and when you lack any said kind of glue, or at least it's easy for those who are under to simply blame the hierarchy that represents the divine power on earth, and without which they would live, and this always happens repeatedly in history, in a much more miserable way than they lived before without. Now this can happen even by states that supersede others. This is the same with post-colonialism, right? There is nothing, there is no doubt even on this field that, of course, some peoples have learned how to govern themselves better than they did, and that, of course, also that the colonial crisis, decolonization, etc., did bring in some cases, and some others were a complete disaster, but this is exactly the point, right? You know, that there are peoples who are able to manage themselves. There are people who are, of course, not able to manage themselves. And there is also nothing deterministic about it, because traditionally we evaluate this not like the Darwinian socialists believed. And by the way, I'm specifically referring to Darwinian socialists, because that's exactly the same saying social Darwinists, right? In this case, and I'll explain why. That is, however, in that way, the forgetfulness, as it was happening in the same West starting in the 19th century, that of course there must be an individual spiritual value of self-actualization in order to be able to rule. Whereas the thing was turning into, because of course this was the age of mass society, and so the fourth estate was given the illusion that, you know, they're equal like the others, that of course there is a socialistic value in being part of, say, an ethnic group. Right. Always remember this. If you feel that nationalism doesn't go together with socialism, you're probably not received first world primary schooling, but also not an actual parental education, right? And you should be probably deprived a substantial amount of civic rights in the process, for the simple reason that not just nationalism was born like a fourth estate mass or radical leftistic terroristic movement, but of course it buys into the idea that you're allegedly a special person just because you belong to a group. And this was radically opposite, diametrically opposite to any kind of imperial Catholic elite traditionalism, which is the only value that existed before mass society. And again, the reason why the 19th century brought that on the table is that not that this was inexistent before as a concept, but because, of course, you know, the lesser people, say the Pelasgian tectonic mass, always hoped for that to happen. Of course, there were strong enough elites that, however, proven not to be strong enough because they were weakening themselves like the world ages. That's how the Ancien Régime ended. And so it left space for, again, the lesser educated, the less intelligent, the less achieving, the less worth, right? That's the point, right? There is no doubt in us that there are some greater powers that, of course, were able to, let's say, maximize certain ways of mass management to their own benefit, which was in part, great part, positive, right? Even far-right-wing actual traditionalists, not national socialists, these are, again, the lesser people, actually acknowledged that, of course, there is nothing even in the excitement of positivism, for example, in the 19th century, the second industrial revolution, etc., and say, oh, look how powerful we became, right? The fact that we went to the moon, that we, you know, have nuclear power, etc. It's all something that, of course, stemmed from an actual value and accomplishment, but this was ever more, shapeless in a way. It was ever more fragmented, casual, random. So we unleashed a lot of power, but so a lot of substance, but the form, at least, is not there yet. And there is hope, right? There is form, actually. There is some form. The typical, in fact, disease of the lesser people is to think that the world like it is now is wrong because, again, the average person is unaccomplished. Well, that's traditionally and exclusively that person's fault, right? It's collectively, it is true, the fault of the entire world, but it is only in the measure in which it is of that person. This is why, actually, why free will and determinism are perfectly compatible under any moral and scientific ground. And people still start instead leaning towards the materialistic idea that, you know, if you don't demonstrate something, it must not exist. It's not that may exist or not, but that, you know, instead we go on living. We do not have the palest idea still scientifically what life is, what conscience is, but to the slightest. Right? It's a complete mystery without any trace of any nearby approach of demonstration, right? And so instead of believing in that, which is evidently what makes things work in the first place, we tend to think that we are sort of isolated, hysterical, isolationistic, again, paranoid, insecure monads, and the world is evil, right? And just because we're not enough as human beings to actually do anything anymore about that. Well, this is actually one of those moments in civilization in which, fortunately, again, as always, right, those who get what they say, the people get what they deserve in general, and the masses are going to sink. Of course, without doing anything, because they're completely spineless, and so the only annoying aspect of that is that, of course, they're dragging the entire quality under, and we have even to hear their complaints, and this is the most disgusting, one of the most disgusting things was going on. So you wonder why I'm talking about this in the first place, because actually what happened with the Ottoman Empire back in the day was, it was a massive thing, right? This is not to say, well, you know, this other typical character of our times is moral equivalence. Every culture is equal, or, a person getting killed is the same of the same value, as if, you know, in any single juridical system in the world, of course, that depends solely on how the person got killed, for example. But people use this, those guys killed more people than the others, so it's the same thing. No, it's not the same thing. It's never been the same thing. Never a human life had the same value of another, right? If you're still confused about human rights, that's just something that we invented as an earthly human nomos, to sort of give a person like you, that of course does not have the moral and personal and cultural leverage to understand the point, that you still are, you do have a potential, and so we act as a society as if you had an actual value as opposed to the potential one, except most of us, of course, will be gone without even matching that say, basic level of potential that we're just juridically giving, of course, has nothing to do with the divine standard that we have to attain, right? So the ultimate thing revealed, right, there are many ways at least to tell the history of the Ottoman invasions. And as you know, I don't think that really, aside from the absolute value, there was in relative terms, let's say, a huge threat, because this is a narrative that we got even from the Enlightenment historiography that most people still think that was actual history. I mean, there was something good in that too. I'm not denying, but, you know, of course, separating the wheat from the chaff is something too much to ask to a person with a standard education, even in the Western world that has the highest one by magnitude in a scale anywhere. It's obviously unsatisfactory, so just think about the rest. But aside from this, that the Ottomans would have, I don't know, showed up on the River Thames if, I don't know, they had not been stopped, even at Vienna. You know how sympathetic I am for the, of course, the annihilation, towards the annihilation of the Ottoman army, you know, at the hands of the most glamorous and beautiful and wonderful cavalry charge in history, led by a crusading army of the major Catholic powers of the time, with a massive help, of course, from probably the action of the papacy, the contribution of the empire of the kingdom of Poland, and actually the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, and more, right? In a time where literally we're Protestants, we're saying, you know, it's good, you know, if Vienna falls, and or at least we don't give a damn about that, even if we live actually in Germany, right? And but, you know, it's better that than the Habsburgs, you know, taking over power, right? And all these kind of things. But aside from that, the point being, it's not that the Ottomans were not posing a threat, in fact, and history is always double threat. You know, if you think that it's one side or the other, it means you do not mostly likely have any capacity of historical criticism or understanding, in as much as you also will not understand accordingly that there is an objective value, right, in a side and another that is obviously superior or inferior according to the situation, in which the West, of course, won, say, it's difficult to say hands down because it sounds as if, again, the Ottomans were not actually an incredibly developed military for the time. There were a massive power stretching from Ukraine to Sudan, from Hungary to the Persian Gulf, but for this very reason also limited in possibilities. The Ottomans were throughout most of their history basically at war contemporarily on three fronts, right? You wonder at that point how even the Ottomans lasted so long in the first place, and a great part of that is that half of the Europeans were yawning at their expansion, right? This is the actual point. Even the Germans, even the Italians, even the Poles, to some degree, even though they were actually the ones on the forefront and that fought clamorously back the Ottoman expansion with their own forces, were actually, say, always working to a level of sort of bare minimum. It's not that different from what we see today, right? There is no doubt that those peoples, as we will see now, understood much more concretely what the system was about, and of course they would be able to enact some traditional reaction that was enough to push this feared but and hated, but in part also respected Turk, because that's the history of it all too, with their own forces. And so, of course, in relative terms, much greater than and in absolute terms, in some circumstances, even than a much bigger system like today's one, right? And I don't need to, of course, expose how dramatically more difficult life was at the time than anything any person today can ever imagine. It doesn't matter if they are under the bombs or if they are persecuted. We live in a magnitudinally easier world, right? For the individual, for the average fourth essayer thinking that has human rights, than ever in human history. And yet 16th century history shows you that sort of bad side of modernity that was already affirming itself. There is a good side of modernity. There is actually the same tradition continuing, by the way. Most of what works, actually anything that works in a theological sense today, is exclusively traditional. Right? There is no other way to gain any power or success without the Holy Ghost, the Imperium, the wind, glory, whatever you want to call it. That's it. Right, to all these people that of course would have been amazed at just, I mean, the basic food, we can't talk to each other like this, we can express our concept all across the world in a click, right? And today's kids, you know, just do not even care about the concept anymore, right? We have gone beyond the sense that even culture or education or knowledge is something that you should be cultivating, as opposed to ask an AI, right? Yesterday there was a guy say, oh, 90% sure that this is an AI, to one of my videos. Why? I try to ask an AI, right? How you know, the things I'm... First of all, it's not going to say what I'm saying this tirade, but even today, yesterday's topic, what was it? Like, about the early Imperial Roman army chain of command. I try to ask the AI about that and see, you know, whether they actually give you any kind of reliable information or to make a point of historical criticism like the one I do, and good luck with that. But that's exactly the degree of blindness, right, to the point we are arrived. So I talked about the 16th century to show you that degree of fourth estate, culturally inferior populism that was already spreading among the masses in the reaction to a pretty upsetting issue that had been happening at that point, right? And I made multiple videos on the Ottomans showing how actually up until just even one decade before the fall of Constantinople, there was actually nothing sort of deterministic, of course, as there never really is, but reasoning in terms of likelihood about the fall of Constantinople, right? Even the siege of 1453 actually was a massive feat of Ottoman strategy and logistics, and didn't have to end well, right? In spite of the fact that Constantinople was almost left alone from the West, but there had been actually, as you know, massive crusades before, ended in disaster, actually, and that's also something we'll have to explain at some point, Nicopolis, Varna. But you cannot really blame, say, the Venetians or the Knights of Rhodes to have just made the Ottomans existing until, I don't know, times when, I don't know, the Tartars were invading Anatolia, for example, which the Westerners literally saved the Ottoman dynasty in, say, ex post. We know how this, say, history went, the obtained that result, but at that point, objectively, on the scale on a non-deterministic activity like politics really is, in a war, in the realm of reality and strategy as well, we're not really a fault, an issue, right? And you have all this whiny BS that is also often clothed into, the Byzantines were the third millennium civilization, these brutal Westerners that needed eventually to have Renaissance created by the Byzantine refugees, as if they, you know, Western Europe was not already microscopically more developed to any degree than the Byzantine Empire, well, you know, since the at least the 13th century. In the 12th, you can find an equivalence, but I'm not even answering here to the delusion. I made multiple videos about the topic, and we'll come back on that, as well as another factor that we... indeed, at that point, that is not played on much, but the fact that it was actually the Greeks that opened the gates to the Turks, right? Constantinople fell because the Byzantines let, essentially, the Ottomans in. And the reason was that if that had not been the case, the Westerners would have taken over, the Latins would have taken over. And that is something that the Greeks said, you know what, we prefer to have just yet another ecumenic empire that objectively made, you know, Constantinople great again. That there is no nothing strange in that sense, and even in the aside from the Trumpian slogan, but to the fact that there is no doubt that was the case for the city, for the history, and in which of course this this local population, mostly the Greeks, at the expense mostly of the populations, not just of the Balkans, but also of Anatolia, because this was not an ethnic Turkish, because there is not such a thing even today, right? Turks today in the state of Turkey are not Turks in any ethnic sense, other than the linguistic one, right? Of course, they descend in part from, say, Turks broadly meant, but not necessarily what we intend even there, as, you know, the Turks literally sprang out of the steppes from the first centuries AD. To take over the Indo-European steppe, which they blended fundamentally, right? There is no doubt even there were many changes, etc. But, say, the Osmanian dynasty that came to power essentially in the Marmara Sea, right? So it's Europe, basically. It's not just because it's from the other side geographically, but because Anatolia had been ruled, especially from the coastland, always by Europeans historically. So the question is, that's an aspect of the Ottoman Empire. It's not merely saying the usual thing, yeah, if you're a right-winger, you should be thinking that these were just, sort of non-ethnic Europeans. When we talk about Ottoman armies, there were the Serbians, there were the Bulgarians. I mean, these were actually Christian people fighting in the Ottoman army and against, the Catholics as Orthodox and etc. That is not to say that, of course, these peoples were particularly enjoying being under the Ottomans, but you got to give the Ottomans the capacity, in fact, to keep them under, as we're saying at the beginning of the video. And that's also something you cannot fort aesthetically, nationally, socialistically whine about as a people, because essentially this people of yours just failed in avoiding half of a millennium of Islamic domination, right? And that's, in fact, as much as the Westerners respected the Turks, right? You can acknowledge, like the Romans said, "Fas est et ab oste docere." It's right. It's just to learn even from the enemy. And this is the reason why I routinely make Ottoman warfare videos, by the way, because it's impressive, right? You know, I was about to marry a Serbian girl who was extremely pissed off with this attitude of mine, but you know what? What do you want from me? Like, it's a macroscopic thing. You cannot study even your own history if you do not study the one in the Ottoman army. So getting butthurt and negativistic and whatever about the fact that, you know, since your people suffered like hell, you know, with entire piles of skulls, you know, created, you know, pyramids from the Ottoman massacres, but the fact that these guys were able more than you that achieved that, well, it's, I think, it's a problem approximating to a mental illness, and you cannot quite easily get rid of that when you're actually carrying out a morally and scientifically historical analysis of the political and strategic situation there, but in a broader sense of the moral and cultural context in which these things really happen, right? So these are actually my hardcore beliefs. I mean, I've been studying not just history, specifically military history, von Clausewitz tradition for a long time, but every single thing I discovered in this sense, it was emanating so naturally just from the mere evidence of it all that I don't know what other world is possible to be interpreted from it. That's why I'm actually enormously disappointed at the way history is taught, or better, not taught today in schools and universities. And of course, even as an academic myself, I cannot quite simply go out there and saying this thing. That's why I also have a YouTube channel. It's not that I don't reveal my identity, because I fear that it would be recognized in that sense. I would say this even in a university, but it's just that we don't even talk about this thing. That's the problem, is that historically, like the debates and the conferences and the research, it's not about this fundamental, right? First of all, because in order to claim it, you should bring a lot on the table, and it is factually impracticable unless I wrote a 1,000 pages long book on it that would still be an approximation given the width of the topic. But and so I restrain myself to, at the end of the day, saying think that every PhD does, you know, this is until the grave, writing exclusively about the topic of your doctoral degree. It happens, but that's why I also think the Schwerpunkt is useful, because the things you hear on here, you will not hear on any other place, including alleged and self-styled traditional or right-wing or conservative channels that basically make just the same old, boiled, boring, and especially wrong rhetoric about what this thing was. Ah, yes, look at the time, how cool we were because we defeated the Ottomans. And then, you know, why did it happen? How did it happen? Why is that we even got ourselves to the point that we had to defend Malta, Vienna? It was even possible for Warsaw at some point to be threatened, and likely the Ottomans would have not stretched further. But the question is, this came through a lot of issues that were happening, first of all in Europe, Reformation, and from the other side, the fact that the same Catholic bloc had surely had its own issues on Rome. I mean, look at the Italian Wars, right? The Pope siding with France against the Emperor at some point, screwing up, say, much of what was already compromised by what had been de facto the end of universalism, the rise of, say, we can't say nationalism because it would be too early, and national monarchies because it was slightly too late, because at least national monarchies already existed and were consolidating, however, at that point. But you get what I mean. I mean, so that idea that there is no such thing like a universal imperial Catholic, so standard, Catholic has a very specific meaning, right? If I say Catholic, I don't mean necessarily the papacy per se. I mean the entire church, because that was actually the original name of the church, in case you don't know. There was never, say, an Orthodox church. Orthodox just means that, yes, you're more or less aligned with the doctrine, but the original name of the church, also but in the Byzantine Empire, was obviously Catholic, right? So if you do not know what that means, and you're still thinking that I'm making here just, I don't know, Catholicistic propaganda in an anti-Protestant or Orthodox sense, you don't quite get where I come from, not just literally, but let's say, but which would be interesting to discuss, but you miss entirely the point of why I'm making videos and you're actually listening to them, so you can easily stop doing so, and at least before being puzzled and asking questions. There are more than 1,800 videos that deal with this issue, so I'd be grateful, given the time that I spent making them, if you at least spot the most pertinent ones on the topic and just listen to them. So the massive turning point, so I'm getting to the point, but this is crucial. These intros are more important than the historical info that I give later, because otherwise the latter would be useless, in fact. The true turning point in the Eastern, say, in the Levantine events was not much even just the fall of Constantinople, right? That triggered mostly, you know, Hungary, Italy. There was, as you know, a concerted effort with, think about Hunyadi, Capistrano, etc. And that was even a moment in which the West could still, again, go. There was nothing deterministic about the Turks expanding the way they did, right? If plague had not kicked in and killed Aeneas, Silvia Piccolomini, the aforementioned leaders of the Crusade, it was possible for the latter to actually reach Constantinople and taken it again. After all, this was not much of a huge task, all in all. It was huge just because there was essentially not the political will to do it. From a Europe that was still sleeping regarding, oh, well, but there are other states before the Ottomans arrive, even France, of course, playing the card of, well, okay, as long as it goes bad for the Habsburgs, it's better. here not exactly, well, yes, at least what we discussed today, it's is about that time, but I was talking now just after Constantinople. And by the way, what I was saying before is also that while there is this enormous winery on the internet, on YouTube, and entertainment, that, look, the Westerners let Constantinople fall, they didn't do anything, which is hardly untrue, when the 16th century kicks in, it's just Tudor history, man. It's the Renaissance, it's the big booming, it's when we woke up, it's when we were so cool, and with it, you know, you let the Ottomans invading freaking Europe and threatening some of the major centers of Christendom. It was lived by the people of the time, perhaps the single most traumatic century in European history, primarily because of the Reformation. Not, by the way, nobody gave a fuck about the fact that the Americas were discovered. That was something coming far less behind. It was mostly just a concern of those who could put their hands on it, and initially, as you know, very gradually. So we have distorted completely the properly the positive-negative narrative. Right, the magnetic pole of historical interpretation of what happened in the Renaissance. And guess what? Nobody really complains about the. You see how populistic history is, right? What is more important? That there were some leaders that were, you know, actually going out there and die up to Bulgaria against the Ottomans for generations to avoid this this threat to spread. And all of a sudden, yes, admittedly, there was even at that time much of a great help, but for which reason, right? Because there were still some countries that didn't want to pay money, wanted to distract others from, I don't know, a Hussite heretic monarch being, in fact, in ruling the heart of Europe. Because that's really what happened, right? That was the guy who actually said, well, you know, why don't we all fight against the Turk? Because, look... you know, it's bad, right? And what did he do, right? He was an actually heretic king in a destroyed state thanks to the fanatism of Hussitism and anti-Catholic ideas that literally wiped out one-third of the Czech population and brought the country back to the Stone Age from the pumping heart, having been the pumping heart of 14th century Europe at the time of the Luxembourgs. And, of course, following, by the way, in the hands of the Habsburgs, because, of course, a country like this cannot rule itself by itself, largely, and the and doing nothing about that. And we remember, however, that rhetoric as, oh, look, there was somebody that was trying to fix things. Can't you see that it's a hoax? Can't you see that it's just like today's people that are saying, oh, let's make an effort, but actually doing nothing about saving civilization? And instead, you know, the most dramatic event of the early 16th century being, oh, well, but you see, from the other side of Europe, people were getting, you know, at least there were some countries at the time also didn't count as the major ones, like France or Spain, or whatever. But, you know, they would have become a big deal, yes, in the 17th and the 18th century. So we should be supposed to appreciate that they began to rise at that point while overtly opposing the Catholic cause and even... substantially going against the efforts of crusade against the Ottomans, to which, of course, they didn't even participate, and in order just to grow by themselves, and so eroding further the Catholic Union, right, for, I don't know, sacking monasteries, because instead of building an actually functional state, which, in the case of the Stuarts, brought to their beheading, except for, you know, making the country paying 10 times more intelligently at that point, but bringing still the narrative of the Papists being bad or whatever, because this is how history really goes, right? It's just a continuous hypocrisy of misinterpretation of what happened, except is easily at this point diametrically opposite what the majority of people believe, because the majority of people are populist, and of course they do not have nor the education, nor the inclination, nor the intelligence to learn anything actually connected with history whatsoever, because it's too much of an effort, poor dears. They are the disadvantaged ones, so we should feel sorry for them. This is not how I make history in the first place. And this is not even too, as we will see today, discard the problems of the Catholics, because it's not that these were just, you know, the heroes of the situation without fault. Everybody had a fault here, including the Ottomans, anyone, right? Because everyone could have done more perspective. But especially the West, because if the West had truly been united, which is the point, it couldn't be at the time, given this characteristic. It's when I get triggered and say, oh, if the Celts had been united, they would have defeated Rome, except they couldn't, and for a specific reason. And so, at least in this time, it's slightly different, because the West was starting to be a massive thing, capable of coordinating itself. I mean, the 16th century is the moment in which also economically, you know, I don't know, from Portugal, they imported the Russian grain. You had not just colonial empires taking shape, but just a sense that Europe, and also, you know, in spite of this dramatic fractures, was a sort of a defined system that dramatically the Ottomans violently, brutally, and traumatically, but also positively, as much as we like this narrower sense of Western Europe, contributed to define, because if there hadn't been an Ottoman Empire such threat, we would consider ourselves in a completely different way, right? Also regarding different parts of Europe, etc. But I'm not going to discuss it today. One other aspect that is necessary to look at the Ottoman expansion is obviously also the Histoire Bataille, right? So after a huge middle finger to Marc Bloch and Ferdinand Braudel, that I actually respect enormously as historians, but of course had very different ideas of mine, you see, this is the point, and that weren't actually saying that military history didn't have to be studied, but a bunch, again, of radically underschooled Marxists thinking to be actually intelligent human beings still for some reason believe today, in fact, recognized that military history had to be studied, and it had to be studied next to political history and social history, the latter of which they were particularly biased towards, because of course it served their own structuralistic Marxistic bias, but that objectively up to the generation of their own teachers had not really been considered, right? In the 19th century still, it was mostly political and military history, and so these guys began to say, well, look, there is society as well, and so we are thankful for them, except for spreading the germ of communism. That is definitely something that any mentally healthy person is, you know, absolutely happy to do without. Also, for having caused by far the single most magnitudinal abortion of the dignity of mankind, including the largest amount of hundreds of millions of people exterminated, so, including actually and mostly being Fort Estater, so that's what actually you get for it, right? Look at my videos on the Soviet abortion of humanity, or the Soviet abomination of mankind, something like that. Just for telling what Bolshevism actually is. That is, considering the means of production as superior to humanity, because of course the only purpose of communism is to destroy humanity entirely. There is no other purpose. It's explicit in the Bolshevik doctrine. There is no other aim, right? That there is no byproduct, there is no even sort of in the anti-humanity idea of anti-mankind, actually, because humanity is actually a negative term, as we know etymologically, but that can be considered as a collateral damage to the same Bolshevism to think that humanity could thrive in some sacks of it. No, it's pure annihilation. And we see what the complete disaster any country that went through communism is today to the actual mental, I mean, to an incredible gap in mental deficit compared to any other country, right? The complete removal of any sort of moral value and ability to recognize or define it. Well, think to be raised in a country which you do not know that religion exists, because you've been prevented, of course, from knowing that. It's not that you have any mental autonomy. It's just you happen to discover that there is something called mankind somewhere outside where you live, right? And that's also quite powerful. But in any case, I will leave my anecdotes about Chinese and Russians and others for other time. Now, on August 23rd, 1514, as everybody should know, the Ottoman army of Selim the First entered in war from the previous spring against Safavid Persia, ruled by the Shah Ismail the First, defeated the latter's army in the Battle of Kaldiran, that is essentially just 2 days of march north of the Tigris River, close to the Bendimai River that flows into the Lake Van. This battle is big. So far I haven't made actually Renaissance battle tactical analysis, but we will have to get in some of them. Kaldiran, as you know, was one of the most important battles of the times. And that shows in perspective also how Western the Ottomans actually were compared to the Islamic world at large. It's as if you had blade and shot instead of pike and shot, because the Ottomans never had quite much of a stopping infantry like the European ones. But against what was essentially a feudal and semi-nomadic army as a hybrid, right, that the Persians still used. This is particularly fascinating because the Ottomans were meant as Turks to stem again from Turkic Central Asia, that is one of the single most bloodthirsty, primitive, brutal and underdeveloped contexts in the history of mankind, and that were instead firing, right, orderly volleys of, firearms into the ranks of, at that point, defeated knights and nomads, right? We're still thinking to live in the age of Genghis Khan of Timur Lake, right? This is not to say that the Ottomans actually didn't have a lot of light cavalry, steppish-like, by the way, from their side, nor that they, of course, didn't have a heavy Turkic or Mongolian influence in their warfare, but that by this point had uniquely started from a Western basis, the expansion of their power. They had a true observance, let's say, towards the respect owed to the Oceanic tradition of Turco-Mongolian rulers. This is also why their Crimean Tartar vassal state was tributed some symbolic honor in that regard, but in fact it was just, of course, a much smaller power at the fringes of this massive one that, especially after having crushed Safavid Persia, would remain original threat, of course, because you can't crush Persia out there in Mesopotamia or Armenia or whatever, but getting into the Iranian plateau is a wholly different story. And so you can't crush it, fragmented, the Romans did it twice, etc., but or even more actually, but they wouldn't, at the end of the day, be able to eliminate, say, the return of a Persian state somewhere there. There was the weaker one. I mean, there is no doubt about this. This is true for the Romans, for the Byzantines. Just at some point, the Sasanians had seemed more powerful. They had attacked the same Constantinople, but they got crushed in the process. So that still says something. Also for the Ottomans, yes, they controlled Mesopotamia, while the Iranian plateau, well, it's the usual boundary, right, that existed between the Sunni Caliphate, in fact, the Shia, the sort of, in fact, knights, when I say knights in Persia, it's as if there were two areas. We've seen it also in the videos about the history of warfare. One in the West is essentially slightly, say, fairly urbanized and sort of even allowing some sort of concentrated power to control the land, and then an Eastern one stretching with relatively undefined boundaries that is much more semi-nomadic oriented. There is less, there are more like shepherds, etc. And there are these nomads, Purin in, that are used also to think about just the Ghulams, the Mamluks, historically. And so to re-inject into this turbulent Islamic world or already new forces that were always threatening power, in a sense, because at least in Islam, the religious and the secular power are one, right? There is no such thing like a priesthood, not technically, nor technically imams or other, let's say, experts of Quranic law actually are. Doesn't matter how heavy they are. Even think about in the history of the Ottoman Empire, the ulamas essentially abortion of Ottoman westernization, and so decreeing, by the way, its final vegetative status in the following couple of centuries, just by European prop. But that's also another story, and you gotta understand again how the Ottomans had arrived to that point, because this, again, this military effort was enormous, right, throughout the centuries. But you can't quite even explain through that the series of victories that the Ottomans scored at the beginning. Most likely what it seems is that the Ottomans were incredibly skilled in exploiting the moral collapse of essentially the Balkans and of Egypt, right? Because both the Byzantines and the Mamluks were some sort of irreversibly decadent systems. At least the Mamluks were faring slightly better, but they had never quite gotten fully patted. They were a hybrid between essentially a bureaucratic but also sort of caste fuels military system of some sort, and in spite of the great economic floridity, right, they didn't have much of the political grip that was required to withstand the Ottoman shock there, right? The Ottomans had some other advantages on their side. Now, I will not simply talk about them, but it's evident from their military history that they were a power in becoming, that the strength also of the Ottoman army was connected to this sort of being, having the most updated, for example, firearm technology, that the Ottomans pioneered until essentially the introduction of the bayonet, that is not, let's say, a firearm technology, but it's at least used for firearms to combine certain things. And their greatest achievement was the granulation of powder that allows to ignite and explode much more, much better, right? Through the oxygen that forms between these little balls of the grains. And that, in fact, was considered, even by famous generals like Montecuccoli after the Battle of Szent-Gotthard, for example, of the finest quality, still in the second half of the 17th century. So also the idea that the Ottomans were sort of, from Suleiman onwards, undergoing this constant decadence that was just deterministic, well, is, I mean, there is some truth to that, but it's not the entire story, especially from a technological point of view. Because also getting technology from others doesn't mean that you're actually that bad if you can use it well, right? And up to a certain point, this was definitely the case, but it's not the entire story itself. Again, I made multiple videos on Ottoman warfare, and I will come back on the topic, so don't worry about that. You have endless hours of, you know, Ottoman military history to browse into through my videos. In any case, the news of the Battle of Calderan were intelligently received with consternation also in Europe, right? Europeans knew perfectly well what the defeat of the Persians in that context really meant. Europeans had tried to ally themselves with the Persian rulers since the time of the Ilkhanate in Ananti. At that time, the Mongols were not converted to Islam there, so they thought even a sort of anti-Islamic coalition. Also, Timur the Lame was notoriously, and I made videos about him too, had diplomatic contacts with France, with Aragon. There were interesting deals being brokered before. At the end of the day, that Western limit of his empire, in spite of the Ottoman defeat at Ankara, with the escape from this unstable empire. So we're stemming from the sort of eruptions of nomadic peoples, more or less mixed with some sort of more sedentary developed force, and so making this big deal of arriving from India to the Aegean Sea, but even there, not really finding stability. That's why you have to appreciate what the Ottomans carried out on a Western basis. I'm deeply convinced of this, that the Ottomans are, that were on the grounds of, let's say, aside from the formal official representative, say, Islamic, these guys bore the title of Caesars, by the way, just to make you understand what kind of mentality they had. But they were being run from a Western basis. There is no doubt about this, that they were in charge of a Western country, physically in Europe, and mostly operated by quite a few, at least in the most productive areas, by Europeans. It constituted the sap of the entire thing. Again, the center of the empire was fundamentally Rumelia and Anatolia. Right. So even in the latter case, you had a lot of intersections with the rest. But aside from this, Guicciardini, Jovius, they all talk about Calderan, right? The latter even tells us that Pope Leo X, learning of the outcome of the clash, was literally, he freaked out to the point of sending immediately, the following November the 3rd, letters to his apostolic nuncio in Spain, France, and Portugal, and even to the Swiss cantons, to the Genoese, and to the Florentines, to say, okay, we have to do something about this. The papal role is always crucial, because you understand that aside from the spiritual guidance and all the, of course, the narrative, the Black Legion narrative that they have about the church actually was doing the job that, the papacy existed for in the first place, that were surely one of unity, right? Had, in fact, this dramatic gluing capacity of keeping the various governments focused, even from places that were more distant from the actual frontiers in which the Ottoman wars were being fought, to contribute, right? And all these countries had their own interests, of course, because it's not just something, happening in, in Hungary. It doesn't have an impact on Spain or on France, right? So aside from those who are really on the first line, they're fighting against the Ottomans at sea, on land, there are also those who are supposed to play their card in that sphere, because simply they have a capacity of political and strategic projection that allows them to exploit the situation, sometimes, however, also against their own fate. Because welcome to modern history, realpolitik, Machiavelli, etc. Now, the fear of the Pope in this case was that the Sultan, once having essentially quelled this Safavid enemy attempts to hegemonize Mesopotamia, because that's what it got down to, right? The Safavids didn't have much of it. It could infiltrate again in the Caucasus and in Armenia. It's the same old story since, the Romans and the Parthians, and nothing really had changed. He would turn after this towards the West. Right, and this is actually what was going to happen. You want to appreciate that, of course, a defeat like the one of Calderan would essentially represent a major setback for Safavid Persia. This is a full engagement of two major field armies on a regional scale campaign that, of course, costs an incredible lot, and eventually, in the outcome, defines much of the stability of the contendants politically at home, etc. So, after such great displays of force and being in from the Ottoman side, in not just victorious but now still having an army of veterans that have acquired further experience from this engagement, would allow Sultan Selim to say, when feeling eminently safe about his eastern flank, to assault in 1516 the Mamluk Sultanate of Egypt, and in just a couple of years essentially eliminating it, right? Essentially swallowing the immense territories that stretch from Syria to the Sirte Gulf, from Alexandria to Sudan, and so becoming the master of more than just a regional dimension, but actually by the centralized government of several regions around that, including, for example, the holy places of Islam, right, from Jerusalem to Western Arabia, along the Red Sea. So, and with all the, as you understand, the also the involvement in oceanic trade that being on the Indian seas really meant, now that, say, the Portuguese, for example, had opened, and not just circumnavigated, were to circumnavigate the globe and to and just had opened the South African route for the East. So projecting Ottoman force towards a much wider dimension that included the Levant, Arabia, especially the western one, Egypt, Sudan, the Libyan coast, and beyond, up to almost Morocco. And that is of course, it's most of the, we've seen often how this reverberated on Europe. This is not where we get to today, because there are other videos about, especially the back and forth in Tunisia, in Algeria, etc. Even in Morocco, because of the fact that were, of course, Islamic rulers that sided with the Catholic ones, and of course didn't want the Ottomans in their yard. And that, however, again, is the product of an acceptance, we can say, from the side, in this case, for example, of the Mamluk establishment, that is actually maintained, as you know. I made also a video about Napoleon's expedition to Egypt. Of course, the Ottomans would keep ruling Egypt through the previous Mamluk case, that, of course, was in part, say, despoiled of the originary pride and sort of spirit and capacity. And that I made different videos about the Mamluks as well, and obviously enough, so I explained there how these guys had come about, what their organization was, what their ethos was, and so on. I will not talk about today, but just for the Byzantine Empire, we have observed how there was a people that basically said, okay, no more with war, we even prefer to be ruled by another people than continuing this. And the reason being that they didn't have any means to defend themselves, which is a sad realization, right? And or at least it is also in the choice of who's going to rule over you, that you show what kind of orientation you want to get, right? The Greeks decided the Muslims over the Catholics. The Mamluks here, as you know, where they were Sunni, just like the Ottomans, but they essentially remained in charge in exchange for becoming an ever more oligarchic power with the rest of the population and all the potential that Egypt had basically rotting under. And yet for the Ottomans to essentially get a fair amount of tribute exploiting these lands and concentrating enormous forces instead against some key fortresses, fundamentally, especially in the Balkans, in the eastern and central Mediterranean, and trying to project their force towards, in fact, Central Europe, Italy, etc. This is the point, in a way, of this video, which is apparently banal, but just think to be living in 1518, 1520, 21, and acknowledging that there is a massive power that has not just conquered Constantinople, couple of generations, two or three generations ago, and that has consolidated as a major pain in the behind, especially for the Western trade with the East. There was some negotiation there with the Venetians, etc., but that had basically taken out one by one the major haven posts of the Westerners in Greece, and that had just literally from one day to another taken over the entire Egypt without basically, of course, this had had a cost, but say just aggrandizing further the power of the empire. And obviously, from a Mediterranean perspective, wanted to dominate the Mediterranean. Because if you're a Mediterranean country, you do not have any other objective, right? Especially if you are from, let's say, one side that quite evidently is also more exposed to the West, telling the truth. This was a major concern of the Ottomans. We see them from the Western side, of course, as, oh my God, you know, these Ottomans are unstoppable. They actually weren't, right? The Ottomans knew that if, say, Genoa and Venice together in Spain had really coalesced their forces, say, just like even after Lepanto, right? They could have actually struck at Constantinople. Machiavelli was quite explicit about this, right? This was not like France, that you could take out the king, but you still have several principalities that will entrench them, so you have to really battle over. Once Constantinople is fallen, the entire Ottoman Empire, by definition, cannot exist anymore. And this is the point. We tend to see these powers as monolithic blocks until you realize it's just the people living there, and different peoples, as we will see now, also with Christians, right? A great amount of Christians, for example, that prefer to be under this power than another one. And they want that stability, that sort of mob-like establishment and prerogatives, privileges, rather than, you know, there were, for example, some Christian merchants from, for example, in the Venetian documentation, it's very well showed, that preferred to go to live in Constantinople, not as Muslims, but as Jews, right? Lots of Jews that were, you know, pretty heavily discriminated against in Europe, and mostly because some of them were becoming rich. There is a very interesting story about a Dutch widow that Charles V was tracking to avoid, you know, escaping to the Ottoman Empire, that eventually succeeded in doing so, that, you know, was a way for the Ottomans essentially to get some extra capitals, because of course, and this is also what we must realize, the Ottoman Empire did not have at all the kind of internal social, economical, or cultural dynamism that Europe had. Right. This is, again, macroscopical. It's not that the Byzantine Empire was a sort of decadent, stagnant, crystallized system that, of course, didn't show any, say, degree of competition, etc. The only thing that basically they got, says small banks in the 15th century, were just copied the Italian model, and the Italians were still, however, in charge of the entire system financially. But say the Ottomans arrive, they are just a dynasty of essentially of warriors, of clansmen that are also relatively civilized within the Islamic world, because as we've seen, they were essentially brought up at that point by the 16th century, by centuries of essentially living as in the West, literally. But there was no further addition. There was not another, say, advanced, developed people were arrived and replenished, say, the Byzantine world of new force, right? There was just a capacity of the Ottomans to call for, say, different amount of populations to the fight, to the jihad, to the sense of universal grandeur that, of course, the system embodied. There was this, again, mostly the decisive factor was definitely the support of the local population, and there is no doubt whatsoever about this. Without that, there would have not been nor the Ottoman Empire nor any other empire. Any empire that exists exclusively because the people under it support it. Otherwise, it cannot exist, right? It cannot happen in physical reality. It's all about the moral support, right? The decisive moral majority of the people. That can be, you know, caterpillar-like because a people can be exhausted morally or being, again, culturally underdeveloped or, you know, incapable of understanding, but still, you cannot govern them without that green light, right? So the only objective of the Ottoman Empire was, of course, to expand further west, to consolidate some positions that would sort of shelter the Levant, the Eastern Mediterranean, and also the Aegean, as it had been for the center of Byzantine power, to from a sort of say Western coming back, which was being brewed. Like, this sense, again, that Crusade had to be relaunched, etc., well, it was pretty mainstream. I don't like the term, but, say, it was absolutely normal. Everybody still believed in it. Nobody said, you know, the Middle Ages finished, there are not Crusades anymore. This is what you have been told, likely, but Crusades went on throughout the 18th century still, so, and you can hardly... There had, first of all, never been a war historically, not even in the ancient world, that was had not been religious in nature. So even distinguishing, say, a religious war in the Middle Ages or antiquity from another is something I've always battled against, because they were all exclusively, without any single exception, based on the sole concept that it was God's will. The Greeks, the Romans, the Celts, the Germans, everybody, it has nothing to do with monotheism. Monotheism technically never, say at least polytheism never existed, even before that was a sort of essentially a monotheistic or anotheistic system. But this was the standard in a world that maybe just right now, because of that sort of irrationalistic and secularistic populism, was starting to mock religion, to cause problems, to even cause the Reformation, which surely was, even in that case, is motivated by some sort of powerful reasons behind that. It was most often a political expedient, but still blowing on the embers of significant social and political issues and spiritual ones, right? Namely, the same, they followed the same. So, again, talking the Ottoman strategy is very fascinating. There is also the Black Sea, but we'll see it on another occasion. We can, going back to Calderan, however, we noticed that the same year, the April of the same year, the Pope had published a true and proper bull of crusade against the Sultan. That, in fact, was, after a short time, as we've seen, to extend his direct dominion over Jerusalem. Right, that had been controlled by the Mamluks, but that was still ideally... I mean, there were, as you know, houses in the west that were claiming the kingdom of Jerusalem. And the ultimate purpose of the Christians was to reconquer the holy places. There would have been, of course, an enormous threat coming from the princes, corsairs, pirates, depending on the situation, of the Islamic of Islamic North Africa, Tripoli, Tunis, Algiers, that at least formally had accepted Ottoman suzerainty, because they were smaller states and they wanted to remain autonomous, but they were at war with the Christians. So if the Ottomans were taking over in the Eastern Mediterranean, they would have surely given them support against the Christians with joint forces. And so we have seen the Algiers expedition, we've seen the Tunis expedition, the back and forth, the defeat, the law. There were, again, local Muslims that were eventually placed by the Christians, that were supporting the Christians. Mostly Spanish strategy would have been, rather than venturing the Eastern Mediterranean or supporting too much Venice, etc., that sense were more connected to Austria and the broader fort, say, between the two branches of the Habsburg dynasty, was interested in. Aside from the Americas and all the rest that was going on. In the aforementioned papal document, Selim, the Ottoman Sultan, was defined as Lupus ille rapax Turcus, immanissimus Christiani nominis hostis. Right, so that voracious, rapacious, actually, Turkish Wolf, right? This an enormous enemy of the Christian name. This of course tells you what kind of were, say, the moral tempers of the time, how the two blocs identified themselves. They weren't really blocs, right? I'm actually very critical of the term that blocs actually existed, and in fact they existed even during the Cold War, so you can imagine in 16th century Europe. But of course the religious identities were quite deeply felt, and so secular politics was beginning to unhinge themselves from it for the aforementioned reasons. That is not a good thing, really. Even though, just for people who think that such things were invented in the Enlightenment, Christianity was founded on the separation of church and state, if you haven't read the Gospels, right? So this was not a terrible world in which people were dominated by the obscure forces of the terribly oppressive church. That, you know, the entire medieval, it's a medievalist speaking, as you know, I have a pretty hefty Christian history playlist. The entire Middle Ages, so the magnitude, you know, civilizational booming of Western civilization, thanks to the Dyad Empire and church, that truly, to some older ideal would have hopefully been in the hands of the same guys, but that were not that effective anymore. The Muslims also tried maintaining the two things united, but also not with great results. So there is no magic trick. It's always about the mankind force, and that doesn't come through wishful thinking, right? The Muslims also had always actually much bigger problems within themselves, religiously speaking, than the Christians did, right? Even at this time, telling the truth. So aside from the political convenience and the rhetorical expression, there is no doubt that the fear that the Ottomans spread was real, right? And together with it, the growing interest towards them of all the peoples of Europe, because even people from, say, England or Sweden could see that, you know, the situation was just to have consequences on their affairs in general, and this was not just more wealth coming, right? There were some, of course, that in relative terms had the possibility of autonomizing themselves and in fact exploiting the same Ottoman invasion to break free of from the Roman Church and the Empire, etc. But this was just a relative achievement and not definitely a big political strategic realization about the fact that, again, a united Europe would have wiped out the Ottomans overnight. And this is no exaggeration whatsoever, right? Again, it's typically Westerner, and through that Western narrative, also for, I don't know, nationalists, fundamentalists, to pretend that the Ottomans were superpowered and won everything because they were unstoppable and they were the great. They were also severely limited in their own options. It's not that you can't simply expand for no reason in a vacuum that doesn't have any circumstantial just factor or even motivational background to. So the demographic, economical, military potential, I think, just if were to be listed, would be just crushing. There is no doubt that, say, the Balkans, Anatolia, the Levant, North Africa were not matching, right, the entire European capacities. They were coming, say, by scale close to that, but not nearly close to the level of qualitative and sort of say expansionistic capacity and even a strategic force that Europe could put together if they had had one reason to do so that at least they would deem to be effective. It's been calculated that between the end of the 15th and the beginning of the 17th century, there was a much greater number of books published on the Turks than on the American continent. And it's also obvious, right? Who's interested in a land of savages when you have, you know, the Turks just next door? And since the reform was approaching, that was the main cause of this further political and strategic capacity that the Ottomans could also exploit the European fact division. There was a great deal of exploitation from the other side of the fear of the Turk. Right, this was again the ancien regime. The majority of people, as always, but even in a greater sense, are separated from the actual government, and so they are easily they're first of all in a condition of psychological inferiority, right? They don't understand. They don't know. And, for example, the selling of indulgences, which was something that, of course, the Protestants protested against, was taken as the evidence that, for example, the regulation of crusading law was at odds a bit with even what should have been the collective involvement in this, right? There was a lot of financing of certain activities under the name of crusade through the indulgences. That, however, were not going, even in the Catholic world, of course, towards the concretization of an actual campaign to crush the Ottoman Empire. So the Turk, that's the name the Ottomans were called in general, right? The Great Turk, the Great Lord as well. This is yet another important aspect of Western mentality at the time. That is, of course, most Europeans didn't really know what the Ottoman Empire was about. They had their own ideas. They sort of westernized the Turk, right? They knew that they were some sort of, in some ways, they were demonized, like the beasts from Gog and Magog, the biblical monsters, the scourge of God, so this divine punishment for the sins of the Christians. That actually was pretty spot on in insight. From a moral point of view, but there was a fascinating aspect after all of this power, because it held an enormous prestige, force, and international even attraction, you can argue, right? Consider that the Ottoman Empire was essentially a unitary system. Yes, it was ruled in a sort of feudal sense as well. That depends on how much modernistically you want to approach the description of the political institutional system of the Ottomans. If you look at the Timars, I made many videos about the Sipais, etc., you realize it was a sort of big feudal system. But there is no doubt that it was ruled from one center only. I mean, you had, like, the empire in the west, except, as if, I don't know, France had obeyed the emperor, and I don't know, Poland as well, right? This kind of thing, if you consider Egypt, the Levant, broadly meant, other lands around. So there was a sense of subjection that the Ottomans, again, had managed to spread over peoples that were not likely as morally driven as the Europeans at that point, that in fact were confident enough to, by a good half to mind their own business instead of helping against the Ottoman invasions. And even in fact, you know, without the Ottomans actually conquering Europe, and actually with Europe booming colonially all over the world in an unstoppable growth, basically, over time, though, right? In the 16th century, this could not be seen just immediately, and say, we're still in the Middle Ages, fundamentally, and we would remain there in some parts of Europe until the 20th century, so you can't quite, say, picture immediately, if you're a Croatian peasant, you know, what's this big international thing. You just know that what's going on is literally people scorching themselves alive and roasting themselves alive, children being butchered, etc. Right? That was the normal happy lifestyle. If you had been living on the Hungarian frontier, from both sides, and that's fascinating as well. But if you look at the aristocratic outlook on the Ottomans and that traditional mentality, of course, as we were saying in the beginning, there was a sort of respect towards this enemy. Because as I said, look at how powerful he actually is and how concentrated his power is, especially. So how much unitary his government appears compared to Europe that had basically now settled itself on a sort of provincial and regional basis of power, depending on bigger, smaller states that existed, and that hardly seemed to have a center anymore, because the empire wasn't that much of a superpower, in spite of the Habsburgic collection of various kingdoms, including some of the most powerful, namely Spain, etc. Because, again, they were ruled in a dynastic sense. They were still separated countries doing different things, even when the same family ruled on the different thrones. And so, you know that European, if you travel Central Europe especially, but a bit all the Western countries that fought against the Turks, you know that there are the Schatzkammer, right? So these cabinets of essentially all Ottoman stuff collection, especially arms and armor, that very often were not just praise of war, but they were literally manufactured by the various European princes that could spend enormous sums just to gift each other with the sort of most resembling and high-quality Ottoman stuff that they even fought with at some point, right? There was a lot of... I made lots of videos about this sort of indistinguishable nature of saying lots of cavalry that was used by Christian and Muslim powers alike all over basically the Balkans, Central and Eastern Europe, right? That you can't, again, the sort of the winged hussar idea, people say, but they didn't really have wings, but you know, wings had been used by everybody there, right? So that it's not that if something didn't get standardized or sort of categorically, you can say, well, there was a thing. There was a massive tradition from literally millennia before Christ about cavalry, for how it had come to be, that bore together with sort of angelic and inferic at the same time majestic sense of complete need of you know, there was essentially holy war, right, and self-sacrifice in holy combat and massive bloodshed and sort of this perfect mix between the Apollonian and the Dionysian to reactivate that sense of grace. This is what the same European nobility had been about, would remain for a long time still, but of course not to the sort of still quasi-tribal excess that some groups that came as far as God knows where from Asia, right, to participate to the raids in Hungary, in Austria, under the Ottomans or the Tatars, right? And there was a lot of fascination with that. Again, the sense that there is a Western Europe narrowly meant today is something founded and defined by the Ottoman threat. Right? It's a bit more complex as far as what is Central Europe as opposed to Eastern Europe. There were also previous divides, of course. But even in literature, in any kind of major cultural, even philosophical reference, you can understand different thoughts among Europeans depending on the experiences they had, and the Ottoman one in some countries are really defining, really, they're remarkable. There is also another idea that probably was understood as fascinating at the time, because there was always a way to flatten the opponent identitarily, say, this guy is just this, the Turk, right? But of course it was full of peoples from everywhere, and same Christian Europeans fighting against the the Catholic forces as Catholics sometimes themselves, but for the Ottomans. As there were, as we've seen, Muslims that were fighting essentially as Christian allies against the Ottomans. And the idea is, in fact, that there was an intentionally offensive ethnocultural imprecision about calling these guys the Turk, right? Because at one point, I made a video that is titled The Great Fear of the Turk, right? Because when the Ottomans began to raid, etc., as far as Friuli, they landed in Otranto, they made quite an impression. And those were some of the most sort of documented era, because we're talking Italy in the Renaissance, but just a few hundreds of kilometers away, you have places again like Croatia, like Hungary, where there was something to, again, that is, it's unspeakable in the level of crudity and violence that was being carried out. And even just in a more direct way, I mean, the landing in Otranto was actually staged by the same Italians that wanted to fight against the King of Naples, right? Just among the other things. At least without support, they were repelled, right? It was not even an unserious invasion, at least the Turks would have liked to push further. But the point was still that the sense is that the Ottoman was still a threat, and as such, say, respected, but at some time also object of contempt. And they weren't all Turks, so the sense is that, again, those who carry out these raids were actually people coming from, I don't know, Bosnia, rather than, say, the ones that attacked Friuli. It would come from there. It would have, again, actual ethnic Turks and Tatars, such as the ones that had in part settled in Anatolia in the 14th century, but that were there also from a much longer time, and in part were settling again, but primarily, at least in a broader, again, there was not an entire Turkic people that with the Ottoman invasion settled in Greece to substitute or to mix significantly, right, as a, aside from the establishment. It's a bit like during the Arab invasions. You don't have to think that there were actual ethnic Arabs, say, invading Spain. They were mostly Berbers in that case, right? They had Arabized elites, which is even something beyond saying that there were actual Arabs in personally sometimes. But in fact, the bigger populations that lived within the Ottoman Empire that largely also remained where they were. So we've seen the same Arabs, Armenians, Greeks, Balkan peoples, the Jews. So this specifically distinguished ethnocultural groups were known as also the five fingers of the Sultan's hands. That is to say, all the ethnicities that populated the immense Sultanial Empire excluded perhaps the Berbers in this case, because they weren't quite so directly brought under by the Ottomans. We're mostly recognizing their suzerainty, but not even the Tatars technically were part of this. But not even the Turks. Again, there is not really a Turkic people in the originally ethnic sense that makes numbers here. Right. And these peoples came to be known also by through themselves as the Ottomans or the Osmanians, right, the Osmanli. And they were actually offended to be collectively indicated with the term of Turk, because it's just like in the West, like the sense is that until the nation state, you are essentially a people that decides to be ruled by one guy that belongs to a dynasty, that is the Lord and has this traditionally redemptional role, and you're part of that, and there are these hierarchies, there are those who rule at the top who are the best ones, etc. So if you would call these guys collectively as the Turks, of course it's not that, say the same Ottoman Sultan was particularly appreciative of guys born and bred, again, in that ghetto of Central Asia, right? That's not really of their taste. You can imagine even for, again, the Greeks, the Armenians, etc., with different degrees, because, of course, many of them were still mixed after centuries of, especially in the Middle East, of continuous invasions and injections of war bands of slaves, etc., from very far away places. And some populations in Eastern Europe were actually largely of European descent, but they had started to live a bit like, say, Turks, talking about the Cossacks, right? But we'll see this in some other term. And of course, in the same Ottoman Empire, the adjective Turk was an insult, because it was, the Turk was considered, in the Ottoman Empire, a rough, barbarian, ignorant, uncivilized individual, if that was, you know, the level of recognition, at least in the humanity scale. In other words, the Ottoman Empire had barely anything to do with Turks, right? That's also one of the sort of weird aspects of today's Turkish nationalism, for example, which is quite embarrassing to say the least, like any nationalism, but in particular the one of a country that doesn't quite have, in that sense, a true ethnic core that you can actually trace to what Turk originally meant from a historical point of view. See, the Chinese can be thinking of themselves like Hans, you can't find, I don't know, people are obsessed, I don't know, the Italians can call themselves the Romans, or the Scandinavians, the Vikings, whatever they think like, but at least they are the same people, right, in practice, without much of a significant genetic change, or even over the millennia. Turkey hardly has that connection with any sort of Turkic background, strictly meant, so it's fascinating. Again, the language is there, but if we're talking about the more comprehensive meanings that a culture has, this is debatable to some extent, but it's evidently much more distant from most countries' culturally and historically developed identities. And the generalized use of the term Turk within Christianity was thus already part of the anti-Ottoman ideal, right? And so the sort of aura of fear and repulsion that sort of the idea of the Turk surrounded it, confirmed it, indeed. Together, again, with this alternating, but, you know, at least it was an impressive, at least the guy at the top was considered legitimately a respectable figure, if anything, for his wealth, power, and so on. However, this was also the language of a crazy era, like the one that was from both sides in general, because of the general fall of traditional values and so on. For example, aside from the Christians that sided with the Ottomans, even at the level of entire kingdoms, etc., this continuous talk of crusade at some point diluted the same value of the crusade, right? It's like how today we talk about religion. Talking about religion 100 years ago was just, you know, I remember from, say, even when I was a kid, like with my grandparents, etc., but the same, even my parents, there was a greater feeling of what was considered respect, there was the sacred, the importance of the matter. Today, every idiot can talk about religion, even maybe by being religious themselves, but of course having hardly any idea of what that is even supposed to mean. In the first place, right? So this is what a bit started to happen at the time. The printing press did not help. It's just like social networks today. It's like way more voices began to pollute the environment. Did this help to some degree, of course, of criticism, etc., and help to bring things beyond, but a side effect was definitely the dilution of those meanings, even from those that were sort of more the ones that should have answered more and more seriously of it. For example, when preaching was carried out, or it was something, for example, that the Protestants were very keen on, the spiritual privileges and the temporal ones granted to those who to whom accepted to leave for the crusade or to contribute to his financing. This was said most, of course, a Catholic thing, even though there were always lots of Protestant princes later on, just, of course, wanted to join, to, especially the youth, etc., to have a name, a reputation. We have often seen it, right? Say that your father was a Protestant prince at some point in the 16th, 17th century, but you, as his offspring, wanted to prove your talents. The major wars that were being fought there were against the Turks. It was still about the sense of Christendom existing, of course, aside from religious divisions. That was the enemy, and so you would go. But at the diplomatic level, and considering that there wasn't much of a concretization of that collective effort against the Turk, at least offensively, there was sort of satirical side of the story, highlighting why, for example, for a reason or another, all these rules, because it was all a legal ether, right, for the crusade, and institutionally, politically, with the papacy, the princes, etc., was sort of deflating in purpose. In Machiavelli's La Mandragola, which is a very funny work, you have a bit this master-like intertwinement of populism, in a way, of sort of lower morality, reality, we can say, with all these, you know, spent words, the clerical sort of doubleness, the same anti-clerical, of course, sort of ideas, propaganda, and some obscene references and game of words on the image of the effeminate Turk, but say a Turk that would rape at the same time. And that is fascinating because, of course, the Turks represented a bit like the Eastern Europe had always represented within the same continent, a bit the area that had been less developed, sort of more effeminated, right, from say the northern conquerors, from the from the Romans to the Crusaders, etc. And it is true that there was a significant difference. Again, that sense of subjection to the Ottomans themselves, aside from their harems and, you know, their eunuchs and so on, was perceived as these guys are a bit weird and morally unregulated, right? They had multiple wives. That corresponded also to important needs of succession that were not that particularly different from other. Think about Henry VIII, you know, but that's in fact what more or less this satire hinted at. There is a passage from La Mandragola that says, here there is a dialogue between a woman and a friar, and a woman says, "Do you think the Turk will pass by Italy this year?" And the friar answers, "If you do not pray, yes, he will." And she answered, "So nothing to do. Like the, you know, God may God help us with this sort of the diabolical stuff. I have a great fear of that Turkish impaling, right? That of course has a double meaning here. And in this sense, it's a tragic irony. Machiavelli was an interesting guy indeed." As you know, he wrote actually an enormous amount of things. Most people just study him as far as the prince, etc. But he is has an incredible amount of production that shows all the multifaceted insight that these authors could have at the time. This also civil servants, but as ambassadors, as sort of secretaries, etc. So this recurrent dramatic appeals against the Turk, the infidel, the enemy of the cross, were used, like today, on social networks by populists to say, ah, no, they're lying to us, it's all BS, it's just about, you know, these politicians that want to get money through that. And this was a sort of, again, open a social network today and see what people say about, I don't know, Ukraine, or, I don't know, about the various conspiracy theories, about really anything that can confirm their own, whatever they think, for essentially a sense of contempt towards those who are the top because they can't be there, right? And there is no doubt there was corruption, as there is today, but as you understand, they were missing, just like today, the entire point that if, you know, the West really wanted, could really wipe from the face of the earth any enemy. And of course, we do not engage into that because we are too soften up and gentrify. And definitely, in 16th century Europe was also growing, right? It was a terrible time, but in absolute terms, of course, there was a recovery from other times, in spite of the wars, in spite of lots of cyclical issues. And through that, think about the Malthusian cycles, right, the recurring, also bubonic plague sort of phenomena, famines, you know, all this internationally, say, interdependent economical issues. The system was expanding, so there were ever more people that were sort of parasitically living under somebody else, and so these ideas were spreading together with literacy that gradually was becoming really a thing. And books circulated, and it was difficult to control them. And just like today, there was not much of an effective capacity of enforcing that. As you know, there were ways to escape, say, I don't know, the Inquisition, censorship, and all this stuff. And that's also how, to say, how modernity in the good side was formed, by trying to sort of regulate these issues, to establish some sort of concentrated power, etc. This mockery, there is, for example, evidence from a Bolognese chronicler, 1518, where you find essentially three cardinals arriving in Bologna, bringing the desperate news that the Turk wanted to come to Italy. And the chronicler says, you know, these guys are just new traps to make money, right? Because the Turk is actually not coming to Italy. Or even if he's doing, you know, that, say, we're being lied to by these guys specifically, and, you know, we can't expect any good from them. Naturally, this is not a positive thing. It's a problem in as much as, of course, this was a very, again, agitated society. But there was not much of a way to uninjure it, right? There would be, yes, the peasants' revolts in Germany, etc., but those were sort of tail strikes of some sort of late medieval peasant revolts that weren't really much of an issue in terms of the ancien regime establishment that would remain there for hundreds of years, and exactly because the peasants lost, by the way. All with radical ideas of the Protestant Reformation that were hardly, just like today, people think, oh, I side with this ideology because I want to make people pretend that I actually know anything intellectually, historically, scientifically about this ideology. It's pure rhetoric. They know nothing about that. But hey, that's what thing goes, right? It's just like anti-Semitism masked by anti-Zionism, right? It's a sort of continuous populistic illiteracy. But I would say, again, of personal unaccomplishment, this is not even about them actually participating to the thing. It's just pretending, right? Because they feel less for some reason. I cannot accept that he must get the thing done. It's truly complaining about it, because you do not have the power to make the world go in the way that you imaginatively think it should or could go, right? The same Machiavelli is impertinent, right? While writing in May 1521, because these were the new sort of minds of the time, right, in many ways. Some were mixed, okay, of course, there were aristocrats mostly writing, but at least the more secularistic, modernistic mentality was sort of kicking in. While in 1521, when Francesco Guicciardini alluded with contempt on the sort of chats on the deluge that should have come if the Turk had passed, and if you should better make the crusade and similar news that were basically worthless, right? So this was the rhetoric, right? They had some truth, at least in a defensive sense, for how the sphere could be exploited. There are people, of course, that are exploited equally in this way today. But there is no doubt that things were serious at the time. That, consider, again, contemporary, in the last year, couple of years, how people pretend to explain politics, world politics, or strategy. It's not that they actually have any insight of how of what armies are doing on the field, how they operate, what is a strategic objective, how it's to be reached. No, they just want to whine about the fact that, I don't know, that their money are spent for something that is obviously going to come back to you in terms of actual advantage that is microscopically evident, but you choose to deny that on the moral ground that you think that even a culturally underdeveloped people compared to you would be better, more powerful, even though this people actually hates you by his own identity and wants to wipe you out. I mean, this is what self-saboteurs really do psychologically, and why they hate the West, and why do you think that Marxism exists? That's the point. And again, there is no difference between right-wing populism and left-wing populism. It's always national socialism. Both far right-wing and far left-wing, as we intend them conventionally today, which is a completely different thing from elite traditionalism, that is not much right, but above, right? Something completely different from communism. In fact, it goes under. Is that there is a national socialistic component. It's the idea, because I breathe, because I'm poor and I live in a, I have a national identity on my AD, I should be given stuff for free. And complaining my entire life because as an accomplished person, somebody else should work for me. And fortunately enough, again, this is how these people are getting under. And they're de facto becoming the new serfs of the world. And I actually have no problem with that whatsoever. If not for the fact that it would be much better to live in a world in which people are provided with any trace of dignity, but that's another story. And this was a very, I mean, the Turkish expansion was a very serious problem, right? In this case, we've seen essentially Italian examples, and it's obvious that the Italian peninsula, for the extension of its coasts, for example, like 3,000 kilometers, and its position that was sort of this watershed between the sort of the West and the Eastern Mediterranean, its proximity to the Balkans and North Africa, had been for a lot of time, especially between the 11th and the 14th century, this mole tending towards the east, right? The Italians had dominated, actually, the Mediterranean throughout the century. They just made a video, I think, last month about this topic. Now, of course, with the Ottoman rise, and also the barbarian one, because the North African Muslims there were being supported by the Turks, importantly, had to become had already become as far as the Venetians, for example, the Genoese fought against the Ottomans. I made a video about this for the Eurasian Steppes border, especially as far as Black Sea was concerned, to become the bulwark of the West. Right? Even though the Ottomans would be actually less of a maritime power than the much more sort of structurally developed Venetian and Genoese navies, for example, they had really began as small pirates, like war bands, right? While the Italians were already with that sort of statile profile, and of course now the Ottomans could put together a lot of ships, but as let's say the general, especially Lepanto, would really and definitively confirm, were not the stronger naval power, even so. But of course, even though the Ottomans would mostly expand on land for this very reason, still initially the most concerned, especially after before the fall of Hungary, the most concerned were the Italians at the end of the day. The Hungarians, yes, had a sort of lesser relevance in international voice, like they were a bit more on their own. Italy was the seat not just of the papacy, but it was also one of essentially the most developed areas in Europe, so it was a much bigger deal. Like something happened in Italy would make a much greater noise, right, than it would do, say, in the Balkans. And this had been a bit the problem. That's how the Westerners woke up a little bit, right? But not all the governments were prepared or committed to some effort. And so the thing really would go worse than it could have if this unity had really been found. And we'll keep talking about this stuff, because the Ottoman-Christian relations are some of the single most important topics that I think are hardly ever studied, like on YouTube, whenever there is a video about, oh, look at this battle between the Ottomans and say someone else, but the entire actual history of it, like how this military events are to be contextualized, primarily from a political point of view, and also a strategical one, which is the one that, of course, is way more difficult to explain in YouTube videos. You see, even though I personally specialize in tactics, as you know, it's striking and painful to see that none of these big sort of mass culture videos make any sort of strategical analysis whatsoever. They can't even technically distinguish it, because people want to see, the little animations with the soldiers that fight against one another, and 10 minutes explanations of how major historical issues, including even down to the bottom, certain unit types who came to be or were about, certain battles, like it doesn't give you anything. It doesn't explain anything. It doesn't challenge you. It doesn't bring you anywhere as far as the actual awareness about what that world was is concerned, right? So we will keep talking about this stuff for today. However, I stop it here. I just hope that you enjoyed this video. If you did, please share it. Otherwise, leave a like or subscribe to my channel if you're interested in my upcoming content. As always, I thank you heartily for listening to me. I wish you a nice time, and see you next time. Bye.